This video covers Dijkstra's algorithm for finding single source shortest paths. After mentioning prerequisites, we'll cover what the algorithm accomplishes and get an idea of how it works before seeing the algorithm and its analysis. After an example of it working properly, we'll see how it fails with negative edges and cover how to use it heuristically. Before starting this video, you should understand breadth-first search. The implementation of Dijkstra's algorithm is really similar. Also, the introduction to single source shortest paths video is critical. It's the first half of this video. You should also know what a priority queue is. Dijkstra's algorithm can find the shortest distances and shortest path tree from any vertex to all other vertices in any directed or undirected weighted graph with no negative weight edges. It generally runs much faster than the Bellman-Ford algorithm because it never needs to relax any edge more than once. The idea behind Dijkstra's is that you keep a growing set of vertices that you know are the closest ones to the start vertex, and you know the shortest paths to all of them. Let's start with a snapshot of the algorithm from the middle of a run to see how and why it works. In this weighted graph, you're looking for shortest paths from the start, and in this graph, the five closest vertices are start, D, G, F, and A, with the shortest distance shown in each vertex, and paths shown in blue. Of those, A is the farthest distance at 8. We assume that for each of those vertices, after a vertex got its correct shortest distance, all outgoing edges from that vertex were relaxed. You can see the current distance estimates and pi values to the non-finished vertices B, C, and E are 11, 13, and 15. The paths for each of those estimates start with the shortest path to one of the finished vertices and then have a single edge to the unfinished vertex at the end, where that last edge was relaxed after the finished vertex had its correct shortest path distance. So for C, the estimate came from a path from start to D to F to C. And for B, it comes from the path from start to A to B. We haven't looked at the other edges in the graph yet, but there are no negative edge weights. So if B has the smallest current estimate, it looks like the best greedy choice. From our knowledge so far, it looks best, but we haven't looked at all the edges. So do we take the path to B or not to B? Maybe go to C or E first? Is B the next closest vertex in all? No matter what non-negative weights you fill in for the rest of the graph, the shortest distance to B will be 11, and neither C nor E can be closer. Any path from start to B, C, or E has to start on finished vertices and then eventually have an edge to a non-finished vertex, and that costs at least 11. Maybe there are more edges after that too, but with non-negative edge weights, you're never going to start a path with a cost 13 to C, then add more edges to get down below 11. So if you can't beat 11 as a distance to any non-finished vertex, and we have a cost 11 path to some non-finished vertex, fantastic, it must be the next closest vertex. Mark B is finished, and now that we know it has its final distance, relax the edges out of it and be done with them. Because B's distance won't change again, relaxing the edges out of it won't help after this first time. Hey, this looks just like where we started, except now six vertices are finished instead of five. The algorithm just follows that logic over and over until the graph is done. The algorithm idea was really an outline of the inductive proof that the algorithm works. That idea can take you from I finished vertices to I plus one, and you're set. For our base case, we can use a starting set of size 1. We know the distance to the start vertex is 0, and we can relax the edges out of it. Let's formalize that algorithm outline. We initialize our vertices as usual, mark our start node as finished, and relax the edges out of it. And then, while there are unfinished vertices, mark the one with the smallest distance estimate as finished and relax the edges out of it. Now, right after the initialization, the start vertex has estimate 0, and every other vertex is at infinity, 0 smaller. So we can actually fold that first round right into the rest of the algorithm. That's the algorithm outline. If you have a dense enough graph, that's good enough. Initializing the graph takes V time. We have to find the next closest vertex V times. We can find the minimum by looping through all V vertices each time. You also relax every edge once, assuming all vertices are reachable, and it takes order V squared plus E time total. Because E can't be bigger than V squared, that's order V squared time. Now, if your graph is dense enough, if you really have order V squared edges, that's as good as you can get. It's linear in the graph size. On the other hand, if you have a sparse graph, that doesn't look as good. The algorithm keeps distance estimates, decreases them when needed, and repeatedly removes the minimum value vertex from a set. That's kind of what priority queues do. Probably lots of students watching this video have seen binary heaps, and maybe even seen that binary heaps can be used as priority queues. We can use one in this algorithm. Now, each time you relax an edge, if the distance estimate decreases, you need to decrease the key of the vertex in the priority queue. If you watched that priority queue video, you should know that you need some sort of handle into the heap to do that, and it will take logarithmic time. That's slower than before, but then each time you find a minimum vertex, that's faster, logarithmic instead of linear. In the end, the algorithm has a different runtime, and it will be faster if the graph isn't too dense. Now, it turns out that another data structure, Fibonacci heaps, give faster priority queues. They're more complex and might have worse hidden constants than binary heaps, so they might only be worth it if you expect to be running on really big graphs that aren't so dense that the first implementation's good. For Fibonacci heaps, delete min still has logarithmic time, but decrease key takes constant amortized time. Some decrease keys might take longer, but the average time for them will be constant. So using Fibonacci heaps will always do asymptotically as well or better than either of those two previous methods. Order E plus V log V. For graphs with at least V log V edges, which isn't so dense, that's linear in the size of the graph. Pretty cool. Two quick points to mention. First, if you look at that code, you should see just how similar it is to breadth-first search. If the priority queue was a first-in, first-out queue, and the edge weights were all one, it is breadth-first search. Dijkstra's is just a generalization. Second, if you only care about the shortest distance to one target destination vertex, you can stop when you find it. Let's run through an example. Like in the snapshot, I won't even show the edge weights until the algorithm actually looks at that edge to relax it. After initializing the graph, we start with the start vertex. I'll color it differently when it's finalized or out of the queue. We relax the edges out, and of course, all of them find new shorter distance estimates to each vertex. Then D is the closest vertex. Let's color the edge from its parent blue when we take D out of the queue and relax the edges out of it. Next comes G. When we relax its outgoing edge, it doesn't happen to change the distance estimate to F, but F is the next closest vertex anyway. It's closer than A, even though the path to A has only one link. After F comes A, and after we relax A's outgoing edges, if we freeze it right there, we have the snapshot that we walked through before. We have finalized distances to the five vertices closest to the start, where A is the farthest at distance 8, and B is the next closest. No Shakespearean dilemma this time. We go to B, then E, then C. Notice, when we relax C's edge to B, its distance is equal to the one already there. Don't change B's parent. Relaxations only change parent values for strictly smaller distances, or else you might lose your path from the start, like here, because of a zero-weight cycle. So here, we relaxed edges out of vertices in the order start, D, G, F, A, B, E, C, non-decreasing order. Those last three vertices have equal distances, but B will come before E and C. They only go their distance by using a path through B with some zero weight edges tacked on. Next, a super simple example to show how the algorithm can fail with negative edge weights. So here, we remove the first three vertices and everything seems okay. We have no negative edges yet. But when we finalize C and relax the edge out of it, it finds a shorter path to B. That isn't a problem for B. It's happy to have a shorter edge even though we previously thought the start to B edge was in our tree. The problem is that we already relaxed the edges out of B, but you need to relax that B to A edge again to find the actual shortest path to A. Once you need to relax an edge more than once, that's not Dijkstra's. Probably you want Bellman-Ford. This leads us to a nice observation about Dijkstra's algorithm. No negative weight edges is sufficient, but not necessary for it to give a correct answer. It might run okay, even with negative edge weights, even if that makes it remove vertices from the queue out of order from their distance from the start. The problem in that example wasn't just that there was a negative edge weight. It was that when we relaxed it, it lowered a distance estimate to a vertex that was already supposed to be done. If B hadn't been removed from the queue yet, or if the distance estimate to B didn't lower, that negative weight edge wouldn't have caused any problems. That gives us a nice heuristic way to try to use Dijkstra's, even if the graph has negative edge weights. When you relax edges, if they change distance estimates to vertices that are already supposed to be finished, the algorithm fails. Dijkstra's will always work fine if there are no negative edge weights, but it might work even if there are some negative edge weights. It will always warn us if it's going to fail, but it might warn you sometimes even if it would have gotten the correct answer. Why try it if it might fail? Bellman-Ford can be so freaking slow that it might be worth heuristically trying Dijkstra first, even if it usually fails. That's it for Dijkstra's algorithm, but now I have to go. I'm feeling faint. Please subscribe.